But I'm confessing I'm not here. You know, I believe in the confession message. I believe in positive speaking. But I do realize that no matter how you talk, no matter how you confess, problems find a way to reach you. And what are the actions that we as children of God, what are the actions that we should take when we're in the midst of troubling times? I like what Numbers 23:19 says, that God is a God that will not lie. God is a God that will not change. God is a God that watches over his word to perform it. God is a God who says, my promises are yea and amen. You can trust me. So the number one action is trust in God and his word. That is the, I know sometimes ministers say this, I very seldom ever do, but if you don't catch anything else that I say today, get that one. No matter what happens to you, you trust in God and hold on to his word. That is the first and foremost action. I believe when you read about the patriarchs of the word, one of them especially Daniel. Daniel, in chapter 6 of Daniel, he was ordered by the king because of a law to be put into the lion's den because he bowed before God. And King Darius didn't want to put him in there. King Darius loved him, but because of the rule, had to do it. Had to put him in. And so as he was going in, old King Darius said, hey, Daniel, the God that you serve continually, may he deliver you. The God that you serve all the time, he will deliver you. And as he was walking into that den of lions, he had that in his mind. He didn't worry about the mouths of the lions. He didn't worry about what was going to happen to his life. His thought was, you know, O King gave me a word, and it's a truth. God will deliver me. And as he went into the, and that's what happens to all of us, because sometimes we find ourselves in that den of lions. We find ourselves in a den of trouble, and that is the thing we need to do, realizing, just like Daniel, I belong to God, and he will not let anything come against me that he's not right there with me to fight the battle for me. So when you belong to God, doesn't mean that you don't have situations or trouble sometimes, because the word says it rains upon the just and the unjust. Young folks, I know that you are, if you're in Jesus, and you've been told by ministers, some ministers, that if you do what is right in the sight of God, nothing bad will ever happen to you. When you start, how many of you are driving yet? Anybody driving? Okay. You'll never have a wreck because God is with you. Nobody will ever bump into your car. Nobody will ever open their door and put a dent in your car in your parking lot because you belong to God. You'll never have a flat tire, so you'll never have to buy another tire the rest of your life because you belong to God. Do you believe some preachers preach that? Make you feel good, but only for a little while. Because when they do happen, the troubles do come, you wonder, where in the world is God? So I'm telling you, troubles will come. They will. But keep your eyes upon the Lord. I promise you, I gave my heart to the Lord when I was 14 years of age. I've never turned on him, maybe for a second or two. And for a second or two, got angry with God. But when it all panned out, God would just smile and accept me and love me anyway and forgive me. And there's not a day in my life that I've regretted at all being a child of his. Never. Has troubles come? You mighty right they have been. There have been troubles. There have been heartaches. There have been sorrows. But I am here to tell you, God is with us through them all. Hallelujah. When the Twin Towers fell, did only wicked people die? No, there was a lot of good people, a lot of Christians that had died. This virus, it only pounces upon people that are not doing good, doing bad. Your son did a bad thing. That's why the virus is upon him. So says the devil. But God says, no. All of us are subject. That's why we all got to be careful. We've all got to be careful. So it rains upon the just and the unjust. The Apostle Paul said it this way, and I believe with all my heart, the Apostle Paul, in all the people that I've read about, that the Apostle Paul is probably one of the most knowledgeable persons concerning the Word and a relationship with Jesus Christ than most anybody that I know in history. And he said these words, "We are pressed on every side, but we're not crushed. We're perplexed." A Christian being perplexed, yeah, but not despaired. "We're persecuted." Nobody should say anything about me. I'm a Christian. But to do, know this, you're not abandoned. You might be struck down, but you're not destroyed. And that's what Paul said. And if you read the life of the Apostle Paul, you'll find he went through all kinds of situations. I mean, more than probably we would ever even think. "But I'm with Jesus. I'm with him. Nothing can go wrong. I'm with Jesus. Nothing can go wrong. Go wrong. Go wrong." Remember the movie Westworld? Westworld was a perfect world. It said, "Come and visit Westworld, where nothing can go wrong. Go wrong. Go wrong. Go wrong." Meaning, yeah, there's nothing perfect. Here on this earth, things are going to go wrong. Things are going to go haywire, no matter what you do. And the disciples, you know, they were with Jesus. I mean, hey, catch this now. We think, well, if we had a visual person, Jesus, walking with us, man, I'm telling you what, I could face an army and know that I'm going to win because I know God is, he's with me. I can see him. Well, the disciples were that way. They were out on a ship, and all of a sudden, the storm began to come. And it was so bad that they feared for their life. And these were trained sailors. They knew the sea. And they knew this was probably the worst that they'd ever been in their life, and they're going to die. But Jesus was with them. They shouldn't have a storm. That boat should always be smooth sailing because Jesus is there. But I believe God put that in the scriptures to let you know that no matter what, as long as you're living in this earth, you're going to have trouble. I mean, Jesus said that. As long as you're living on this earth, you will have tribulation. But be of good cheer, he says, I've overcome the world. And he is an overcomer. He lives in me, makes me an overcomer, because greater is he that's within me than he that's within the world. I think about Peter. We talk about this story a lot, and I've got probably two or three teachings on it alone, just this one incident where Peter sees Jesus out on the water. It's in the midst of a storm. I mean, it's way yonder bad. And Jesus is walking on the water, and they thought it was a ghost, a death angel. They're going to die. Here it comes. And Jesus said, no, don't be afraid. It's me. Don't be afraid. And Peter said, "That's you. Bid me to come walk on. Let me walk on the water." And Jesus said, "Well, come on." And Peter got out of the boat, and he walked on the water. Have you ever tried walking on the water? I did. I've run off a pier before. I'm thinking, I know I'm gonna make it, and if I make myself light enough, I'm gonna be able to do it. First step, complonk. But Peter got out and walked on the water. He was walking on the water. As long as he kept his eyes upon the Lord, as long as he kept his eyes upon the truth, the Word. But all of a sudden, I can imagine a real stiff wind came blowing against him, and he turned, and he looked, and he saw the wave, and he thought, man, I'm going to die. Jesus, I'm going to die. When he got his eyes off of Jesus, he sunk. If we keep our eyes upon the Lord in the midst of the troubles that we're going through, it might not make the troubles go away, but it'll make the troubles where they can't hurt you. And will they last? No. I said a couple of weeks ago, we're going through these things. The word through is a favorite word in the scriptures. Your lot in life is not set forever like this. If you're going through a hard time, it doesn't mean, well, the rest of my life is ruined. This is the way I am. No, you're going through. Now, you'll stay there as long as you keep your eyes off the Lord. If you keep your eye on the problem and the symptoms, you'll stay there. But if you keep looking up and saying, Jesus, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. I'll go through this thing. There is light at the end of that tunnel of darkness. I read a story about Billy Graham's daughter wrote this. And she said, you know, you may be going through a most difficult time in your life, but let me encourage you with God, that God's word will sustain you. It sure has sustained me. The pressures of pain and suffering, my son having cancer, the loss of my mother, my father, and my husband's illness, and then finally his death, through it all, God sustained me. Some days, I'm only capable of reading a verse at a time, yet the supernatural life-giving power of God's word penetrates my suffering and emotional upheaval, giving me strength to keep on going, one day at a time. Let the word of Christ, Colossians 3:16, dwell in you richly. His peace and his hope and his power is all yours, and it's available to you. Because God's word is the final authority. That is it. God's word is the final authority. So don't look at your symptoms. Look at the word. Don't fear your fears. Praise the Lord despite it all. That's actions in the midst of problems. Also, believe the opposite of whatever you're fearing. My grandchildren, when they come and spend the night, they always say, Granddad, tell us a story. And I'll say, oh, once upon a time, there was this little boy, and he could fly and all this kind of stuff. And they said, no, tell us a scary one. I say, okay. So I'll turn the lights down, and we'll sit and we'll talk. And about midway, they're saying, now, that didn't really happen, did it? And I said, oh, yeah. And before you know it, I've got them to where they're saying, you're just kidding, aren't you? That is just a story, isn't it, Granddad? And I said, oh, I'm getting them to where they're even talking about it the next day. In fact, a month later, they're still talking about it and telling me, over there's a stunt people. You know, I don't know if they're going to get me. But I'm just playing with them. The devil doesn't play. He'll tell you a story. He'll put you in it. And oh, he'll even make you feel the story. He'll make you feel those things. Symptoms will begin to arise. You'll start believing what he tells you. And if he doesn't, he'll even send reinforcements to tell you. I recall having a problem one time, and I thought, oh man, this is probably bad. And because I said that, the devil sent reinforcements. And they told me, you know, my uncle died. I said, what did he die of? All this. I said, what was the symptoms? Well, you know, he was hurting right here. I said, oh, man, that's where I'm hurting. What kind of pain was it? That's the same kind of pain I got. And before you know it, I got myself dead. And the devil will keep pushing you till you finally feel that way. And then you get into the word. That is my greatest peace. When things go wrong, get into this book. Get into the book. and start reading. You say, where? Just start reading. The Holy Spirit will show you something that'll help you get over. And one of them, as I've told you in the past, was 2 Timothy 1, verse 7. God didn't give you that spirit of fear. God gives you love, power, and a sound mind. I said, well, I'm fearing. If it didn't come from God, who'd it come from? The devil. And the devil is a liar. He's the father of lies, the Bible says. So therefore, if he's lying to you, believe the opposite. So you start praising God for the opposite. Before you know it, bam. And you know something? I began to do that on that ailment. You know something? It went away completely. I have no idea what it was, but it didn't last. It didn't take me under. God's word. Hold on to his word. Meditate upon it. Think about it. Quote it. Speak it out loud. And realize it'll never, ever, ever fail. Whatever is tying you up, whatever is binding you, whatever is fear in your mind, whatever symptoms you've got, whatever situation you're walking through or living in, God has got an answer for you. All you got to do is ask, seek, and knock, and it'll be open to you. The asking, seeking, and knocking, well, the asking, of course, is prayer. Lord, I need help. I need help. And the seeking is getting into the Word and then reading it. Keep reading it. That's a knocking to me. And God will reveal something to you that's going to help you. Believe God and don't waver. If God gives you a scripture, don't waver from it. A person that wavers, is, according to James, is like a wave of the sea tossed about by every wind to and fro. But be like Ephesians chapter 6, the armor of God, and hold to the word. The word is the sword of the Spirit. And what did Jesus do? Jesus was tempted. Jesus was going through a real bad time. And all Jesus said was, it's written. It's written. You don't have to fight the devil, argue with him. No. Just quote the word to him. He can't combat the word. And speak positive. I know some people, I'm going to tell you what, they can't talk without negative words come out of their mouth. Now, granted, yes, if you got a prayer request, hear the prayer request. But there's some people that give you a prayer request, but they don't want to share that prayer request to everybody individually. One lady, she had a legitimate prayer request. And I talked with her, my wife and I talked with her about 45 minutes one day. She was in the hospital. And I finally got her to the place to where she began to confess. You know, I'm feeling better. You know, I think I'm going to be all right. Oh, thank you. Thank you so much for coming. And when we left, some other people were coming into the door. And I thought, I want to hear her confession. I want to hear what great things she's going to say about God. As soon as they walked in the door, I heard her say, oh, I'm going through such a hard time. You just don't realize it. And I thought, man, she's a broken record. Negative, over and over and over again. And you know something? Because of that negative talk and believing, because if you say something enough, you're going to get to believing it. And she began to believe it. And sad to say, she took her life. Just maybe a month or so later. Folks, I'll tell you, you can't beat actions in trouble like depending upon God, his word, meditating upon it, claiming it, holding to it, confessing it, and speaking it out loud and praying it back unto God. I know that sounds like a whole lot, but that's the actions. Hopefully you'll realize, I don't have to let this thing take me under. I don't have to walk in fear. My God is my strength. And as long as he's with me, I'm going to make it. God is with you. When the storms come, speak to it in the name of Jesus. Peace be still, because you got that kind of power. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, we do have that power. And we've got power to take care of situations in our life by speaking that word. It's not just a matter of confessing it, not a matter of just saying something, but it is a matter of believing something in your heart so strongly that it can't help but come out from our lips. Yes, we may be in pain, and we may say, I am in pain, but I'm overcoming in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that we can add all that word to that statement. Yes, I am sick, but by his stripes, I am being healed. Hallelujah. Yeah, I do have a need, but he supplieth all my needs according to his riches in heaven through Christ Jesus. Yes, I have sinned, and I know I'm not worthy to ask him to forgive me because I might mess up again. Well, I got news for you. You will. But when you do, get back up again and ask him to forgive, and he will. And today, there may be one of you that says, you know something? I need to give my life to Jesus. I need to ask him to come into my life. I tell you, there's no better life to live. Proverbs will even tell you over and over again, there's no better life to live than that life that's born again. And Father, I thank you that if under the sound of my voice there's somebody here that does not know you, but they'd like to, that in the privacy of this moment, they will receive you as Lord of their life. With every head bowed, no one looking around. Don't be concerned about a person in front of you or beside you. No. It's between you and the Lord. And me, because I'm going to pray for you. If you don't know Jesus as your Savior, but you'd like to, you'd like to know him, a person who's going to help you, walk with you. If you don't know him, but you'd like to, would you just raise your hand right now? No, don't worry about people around you. I want to receive Jesus. I want to be born again. I want to be ready for heaven. And Jesus, I know, is the only way. Pray for me. Include me in this concluding prayer. And I will. You just got to let me know you want that in your life.